Well, welcome to the talk, to the overly broad talk about dirty computer tricks. Before I start off, I think I would just like to remind you that the operating system is this enormous mass of code that both serves to sort out user programs to not interfere with each other overmuch, and also to work around bugs in hardware. So this is a graph that I made by building Linux 3.10 RC2 with make all mod config, and then parsing all of the module imports and exports from each .o file to figure out what files depend on what. This is just the kernel directory, which is all the core kernel code. And the green, all these green arrows, which you can't really tell because it's a horrible mess, are interconnections between files inside the kernel directory, and all the red lines, which you can see that horrible smudge at the top of the screen, are all interconnections between directories. So let's zoom out a bit. So that's the kernel. And now we get into other things like the lib directory, which has spin locks, queues, and other things. The memory manager, also another popular one. Unfortunately, GraphViz seems a little bit strange in its choice of where to lay things out, because for some reason the PDP driver ends up next to MM, because clearly that's more important than, oh, I don't know, x86 kernel CPU. So anyway, moving along, we keep zooming out. This is what the full diagram looks like. Remember, at full magnification, you saw about this much. So just a reminder, the kernel is very, 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 very complex. Oh, I'm sure there are plenty of bugs all over the place. I am kind of wondering how this giant block of code ended up out here. I'm not even sure what this is. Oh, key maps for RC controllers. Awesome. All right. On to the actual talk. So this is Dirty Computer Tricks. I intend to start with a quick overview of how computers work, then start delving into different categories of problems, the first being weird problems you can have with electronics, the second being weird problems that get introduced by all the various caching layers. If there's time, then I will proceed on to hardware losing its brains, which is quite an interesting problem to have. And finally, I have this pseudo category at the end called application issues, which is really more how to paper around hardware problems. Also, I figured dirty computer tricks is a bit of an overly broad topic, so I decided to narrow it to data storage because, quite frankly, when your video card breaks, you just go buy another one, whatever. When you lose your data because of hardware problems, people get angry and all kinds of support issues get filed and stuff like that. So, without further ado, some of you might remember that all computers are supposed to be some kind of Turing machine. This is a classic model of a computer that was devised by Alan Turing in the late 30s. And basically, his model of a computer was you'd have this long tape and some kind of cursor thing that remembered the position in this tape, some state registers, and a transition function to move between various states. And this is basically what a modern computer does. We don't have tapes anymore. We have disk storage, flash storage, whatever. But we still have a storage cursor, an instruction pointer, and we still have registers so that the CPU can do arithmetic calculations and the like, and transition functions, which are either encoded in the instruction set architecture, after this, do this, whatever, or at a higher level are encoded by whatever software you write. So let's start looking at problems with this tape. First of all, we don't really use a tape, as I said earlier. We actually have tons and tons of storage, but each of these storage systems have different performance characteristics. Some of them are really fast and can provide great, huge gobs of data instantaneously. Others are kind of slow and involve moving things around, or in the case of actual tapes, winding tapes around, which is particularly slow. So in general, we lay out all of these storage systems from the CPU in order of slowness. You put the fast things close to the CPU, you put the slow things way far away because, hey, they're slow, whatever. And this is how we create the caching hierarchy. The CPU has registers which are really, really, really fast, but there's not a lot of them. There's like 30 of them, or a couple hundred of them, depending on the processor, then it has level one caches for just that core, level two caches for core pairs these days, level three caches for the whole package thing that you can buy in a cardboard box. And then from there, memory acts as a bigger cache. And then, let's see, going out from there, you probably have some combination of flash storage and disks and maybe tape. Or if you're particularly inclined to the cloud, way at the end of that entire hierarchy. And in order to speed things up when we try to record data, we've also introduced the notion of write caches, which is basically the idea that I want to write something, so I'll dump it into the next layer of cache, and at some point it will go and flush it out to the next layer of cache, and it will keep going over and over and over until the end, right? But, you know, first, let's take a look at hardware. Cosmic rays from space. This isn't actually a joke from the 1940s sci-fi movie. Turns out that higher energy neutrons can provide plenty of electromagnetic interference. And what this usually results in is weird bit flips in your computer's memory. As I mentioned, everything has its own cache, or most all devices these days have some kind of storage or memory storage associated with them. There's buffers everywhere. Your hard drive has its own write cache. Your network card has a small amount of memory to buffer incoming packets while the CPU is busy dealing with other stuff and can't get to it. Let's see. I think, as I recall, the PCI bus has some limited amount of buffering too, but basically what it amounts to is everything is, there's little chunks of dark storage hidden everywhere all over the computer, and what this EM interference does is it occasionally flips bits in them, so your nice value of 2 is now suddenly 3. Now, we previously thought, oh, well, you know, this doesn't happen, and it's, you know, it's the kind of thing that happens once in a blue moon. And for the most part, it does actually only happen once in a blue moon, because most people's computers have so much memory in them that none of it's full. And the bit flips are more likely than not to happen in some unoccupied piece of memory, so who cares? Unfortunately, a large, well-known vendor of computer software that exists on the internet tends to like to load down their servers until their machines are running at close to or as close to 100% memory utilization as they can get. So they did a study back in 2009 to figure out how often do these weird bit flips happen, because they build their server farm out of commodity hardware with no error checking because who would want that? Well, they discovered that in any given year, 8% of the DIMMs that they had experienced some kind of error event. Most of these turned out to be single bit flips, which if you have ECC memory is useful, or is fine because it can correct for that, but if more than one bit flips, then your whole system is hosed. So, you know, on a practical level, what does this actually do inside of the computer? Well, the obvious one is memory buffer corruption, and basically what that amounts to is you fill some memory buffer with, I don't know, the great American novel that you've been working on for the last 5 years. It's sitting around in memory waiting to get written to disk, and if one of these cosmic rays or whatever happens to hit the memory buffer, it will change bits, and suddenly you have Fuzzy Wuzzy was a bear instead of the great American novel. This is kind of annoying, but you all have backups, right? This actually gets worse. The next point is data gets written to incorrect locations on disk. Let's say that your great Fuzzy Wuzzy poem was supposed to go to block 20. What happens if if the piece of memory that's storing the fact that it's supposed to go to block 20 suddenly gets bit flipped and now it's supposed to go to block 22, or it goes to block 22. Your computer's file system will say, oh yeah, that Fuzzy Wuzzy thing, yeah, I stored it in block 20. It got written to 22. And what's in block 20? Well, something else. That's kind of nasty. And other things, I/O device command completion. This is a problem that I'm actually wrangling with right now. I have a temperamental server that keeps throwing ATA bus errors, and I haven't figured out for the life of me why. all it tells me, or all it throws back, is that I/O commands get to it in a corrupted state, at which point it starts choking on that, and I'm not really sure what that's all about. Actually, I don't really suspect it's memory problems at this point, but kind of hard to tell. So the fix to this is ECC memory. It can fix single-bit errors. It actually is capable of detecting multi-bit errors, where instead of just flipping one of the bits in the byte, multiple bits get flipped. And while it can't fix them, it will at least notice, and it will stop the machine. Or what it really does, well, what it really does is it notifies the ECC controller, which then does some magic sauce, and the magic sauce can either be stop the whole machine dead in its tracks, or in the particular case of Linux, you can actually rig it up to run a user space program to gracefully deal with that. And what usually happens is that the kernel marks the memory pages dead and kills off any processes that happen to be using it. But anyway, it's kind of besides the point. The thing that I'm really wondering about, aside from where the siren is going, is why ECC is not more widely deployed. Because we all look around and, you know, we've got these smartphones with the gig of memory in it, and they don't have ECC. This laptop has 16 gigs of memory. It doesn't have ECC. And think, well, this guy who's talking in front of the room, he said that memory corruption probably won't hit something that's in use. Well, it actually did hit me. This laptop, which I've only had for about 5 or 6 months, I noticed about 3 months ago that something in /var was corrupt, in particular, the Debian package manager info. What I eventually figured out had happened is that something or other had managed to flip a few bits in the memory, and this had caused the file name portions of the directory database for varlib/dpkg-info to change some of the file names from lowercase to, unfortunately in my case, uppercase, which caused no end of confusion to the Debian package manager, but was fixed by a simple rename. And, you know, this laptop doesn't really get used for much. At any given point in time, only maybe about 10% of the memory's in use. So, yeah, you can play the probabilistic game, and it can still bite you in the butt. So, let's see. The other thing I mentioned, I/O command corruption. These days, most I/O device protocols actually have CRCs put CRCs into the command fields so that the device can figure out if the command has been corrupted in flight and reject it and tell the operating system to try again. This is very nice because in the old days it wouldn't do that. It would just write out garbage, and if it sucked, well, too bad. Also, I think I sort of touched on this already, file systems don't like bit flips because metadata, which is the data in the file system that describes where the files are, what they're called, who can access them, so on and so forth, that's actually pretty high-value information. If you destroy a small chunk of metadata, you can cause massive, massive corruption on the file system. One customer problem that I worked on once was a client was trying to set up a cloud with a bunch of cloud servers running ext3, and they said, well, it ran fine until one night when everything just went kablooey on us. And I eventually figured out that what had happened is that some bit had gotten flipped in the block bitmap, which marked one of the file databases as being unused. So the next time they mounted the file system, the ext3 driver read that and said, oh, this block is not in use. Let me go allocate it to this other file and write garbage all over it. Whoops. It then reread that block in at some subsequent point and said, well, Fuzzy Wuzzy Was a Bear is now my block bitmap database. So lots of these blocks are no longer in use. And the end result was a single bit flip destroyed about 200 megabytes of data. Yay. So these problems with bit flips in the file system are fairly easy to detect. If you only care about detecting them, you can put checksums onto all of the metadata, and they will at least tell you with a fairly high confidence that whether or not the data is still intact. ButterFS, which is the new shiny in Linux land, can raid one metadata. If you feed it a pool of disks, it will replicate the metadata on all the disks and So if it detects through its checksumming mechanism that some of the metadata has gotten corrupted, it will go read another hopefully clean copy off of one of the other drives. EXT4, which is the popular Linux file system right now, is growing the ability to checksum metadata, but the checksums tell you about corruption, they don't really help you to fix the damage. Either hopefully you have a good trusty FISC tool, or it'd be kind of fun if someone tried to implement ECC, but nobody has yet. Yeah, I would, but I don't have quite enough time. So problem number two, cache coherency. So normal I/O runs in what's called buffered mode. So that means when you issue read and write calls to a file, all that data gets copied into some page of disk, some part of the disk cache in the computer's memory, not on the disk itself, and it just sits there. It's dirty. The operating system has done enough bookkeeping to ensure that it remembers, oh, this thing is dirty. We need to flush it out to disk at some point in the future. But it will just sit there until you hit some kind of commit event, whether that's a flush timeout or an explicit flush from user space programs or someone else filling up the memory is anybody's guess. But as you can imagine, this means that your dirty data is sitting at one level of the cache hierarchy, and in particular, it's sitting at the volatile level of the cache hierarchy. We haven't even tried to write it to the spinning Rust yet. That brings us on to the next level, disk write cache. When we actually do try to write the data out of the computer's memory onto the stable storage thing, guess what? There's another cache layer there, because we all love caching. Writing data to hardware is actually a slow process. You have to move hard drive heads around and spin this glass thing around and write stuff and maybe even verify it. And it gets even more complicated if you're writing it to an SSD. So drives cheat by adding more buffers in order to amortize the cost of actually writing to the media over, hopefully, the cost of several programmed writes from the operating system. So, even after you flush the dirty data out of main memory and sent it to the disk, it's probably still sitting in some non-volatile memory on board the disk. Yay. So there has to be some way to ensure that write cache contents can also get flushed out to the disk. This is just kind of an extension of the saying, if you don't have a big enough hammer, get a bigger hammer and continue beating on the computer. So the supposed fix for this is cache flushing. There's a set of Unix system calls called sync, syncfs, and fsync that, in decreasing levels of severity, cause the computer to try to ensure that all the data is actually committed to some kind of stable storage. Sync is the most general one in that it will take any dirty data anywhere in the system and write all of it out. This can be kind of an expensive operation. Your average hard drive runs at about 200 megabytes a second, maybe. Well, okay, your average laptop disk is probably more like 90 at this point. And if you have 16 gigs of data, or 16 gigs of memory on your laptop, think about how long that will take to write all of that out if you have 16 gigs worth of dirty data and your drive runs at 90 megabytes per second. Several minutes. The second one is syncfs, which is flush everything out on just this file system. And fsync is probably the most useful one because it says, given this open file descriptor, flush all of its dirty data out to disk and don't worry about the other stuff. That's probably the one that makes most sense for most people. There's also other weird things. There's this flag you can pass to the open called osync, which says run everything in synchronous mode, which ensures that when you write, it ensures that the system call doesn't complete read or write or whatever until the operating system has flushed the data out to disk and received the confirmation from the hardware that, yes, indeed, I have written it out. It's kind of slow because normally you just go right to the cache and finish. There's also just to make this Unix I/O soup even more complicated, there's also this odirect thing which says, don't use the page cache. I want to read data directly from the drive, and I want to write directly to the drive. There's a weird little caveat with that, though, in that it bypasses the page cache, but that's all it does. If you write data in odirect mode to a hard drive, it's perfectly well within its rights to just leave it in the write cache and not flush it. So you still need fsync. Also, I discovered the other day that there's this interesting feature of Linux where if you open the same device file in odirect mode and in buffered mode and read a sector in buffered mode, close the file, write the same sector with the other one that you opened in direct mode, close that file, reopen the device in buffered mode and try to reread it, it doesn't reflect the things that you just wrote, which is very, very weird and confusing, particularly because I was playing around with VMs and ended up hosing one of my file systems this way because I thought I had written it. The underlying hardware knew that it had written it, but the VM didn't know that it had written it. Oops. However, there are also problems with disk flush caching. Certain disk firmwares like to treat cache flushes as no-ops because this way their performance numbers are higher so they can win benchmarks, which means more money for them. This is kind of bad because we just told it to do this thing for safety and it said, screw you, no. So there's not really any good way to figure out whether or not this is happening other than to do a write test in write cache mode and non-cache mode. You can also flip bits on the hardware to change that. And if you see a gigantic speed hit when you enable or when you disable the write mode, or sorry, the write cache mode, then you probably have a properly functioning disk drive. If, however, turning off the write cache makes no difference in performance, you probably have one of these crappy disks. Fortunately, the ATA protocol specification in all its wisdom now has a new flush command called really flush. And according to all the vendors, that actually really flushes the cache. All right, on to part three, where hardware loses its brains. So I mentioned that writing to an SSD is a complicated dance earlier, because on a magnetic disk, you basically just spin the disk around and you position the head where you want it and you send an electromagnetic signal and it goes and changes some magnetic substrate. Flash is a bit more complicated because you have to reprogram a bunch of capacitors somewhere in silicon. And it really only makes sense to do this in large blocks of a couple of megabytes. So when your SSD says, oh, I'm an 80 gigabyte SSD, which means that I can store things from block 0 to block 160 million or something like that, it's really just presenting you with a fiction that's supposed to look like a spinning disk. What, in fact, it really does is everything you write to the disk, it will try to write it out in linear order so that it, or at least in batched order, so that it can write full pages at a time. And then it has this thing called a flash translation layer, which says, if the operating system asks for block X, that's really mapped to this chip and this column and this row, go get it from here. Because, this is basically another abstraction layer. Unfortunately, it's another abstraction layer. So every time you flush writes out to an SSD, it has to go and take a block, erase it. Well, actually, it takes a block, it decides what else it's going to write to that same memory, erase page in the flash, it erases a page, programs the entire page, and then it has to update its translation layer. Wow, it's a lot of stuff to happen, and where could things go wrong with that? Well, what happens if the power goes out while you're updating the flash translation layer? If you're really lucky, it's using some kind of copy-on-write-ish tree thing so that all you lose is the last few seconds or minutes of updates because the tree that it was constructing is now just disconnected and gone. If you're unlucky, it bricks the whole SSD because maybe you wrote complete garbage to the root pointer or however these things are implemented. The flash translations layer software is closed source and you can't see it, so who knows what it does. And so some SSDs brick themselves, and you think, well, okay, I'll just avoid going to Fry's. Well, it turns out that last December, some university published a study where they bought up every single kind of SSD they could get their hands on, consumer, enterprise, or otherwise, and they tried repeatedly power cycling them to see which ones would fail, and they discovered that 70% of the SSDs came up with some kind of failure, or some kind of failure was defined as stuff written to the wrong location, or old contents, or we wrote this, and the disk said it was written, and then we flushed the cache, and it said it's really, really written, and it's still gone. And they said that about 13% of the SSDs would just plain die, and they'd come up as either 8-megabyte non-writable devices, which is bizarre, or they just plain wouldn't recognize at all at next reboot. So how do we fix this? Well, most SSDs, if you pop them open, which you're not supposed to do because it voids the warranty, have a pretty large capacitor buried inside that aluminum shell designed to handle this. And basically, it's a little tiny amount of electricity storage so that when the voltage levels coming in on the SATA connector start dropping, it can quickly flush everything out to the FTL in a big rush, hoping that it gets it done with enough energy to then properly power down before the capacitor dies. Of course, you know, there's no way to monitor what the levels are in this capacitor, so you really have no idea whether it's fully charged, half charged, or totally empty. The other fix, of course, is just to have a standard battery backup and shut down your system the nice way. And of course, there's also the other solution. Buy one of the SSDs that doesn't do this. Unfortunately, the paper said that they would not reveal which drives bricked themselves and which ones performed consistently fine because they were afraid of embarrassing the vendors whose drives bricked themselves. My guess is this means that you could go and find this paper and find out who's sponsoring their department and then figure out who it is from there, but I won't speculate on such things. So while we're on the topic of low voltages, so we all think that computers are these nice digital machines where the only values you have are zeros and ones, right? Well, it turns out that the way that binary gets implemented in an analog device such as a computer is that it uses thresholds. So it says, if we see more than this voltage, we're going to consider that a one, and if we see anything under that, we'll consider it a zero. So hopefully your nice square wave stays above this threshold and you can detect ones easily. But there's this minor question of what happens when the top of this square wave gets kind of close to the threshold. In particular, you might notice on modern CPUs, you can vary the processor frequency and the voltage that you're feeding it. And while the upper range of the voltage is always, well, it started out at like 3.3 volts and is slowly decreasing its way towards 1 volt, but you'll notice that the low end of that range has always stayed around 0.85 volts. And according to the electrical engineers, the reason why this is because it's really hard to build digital circuits that work properly with a threshold level below 0.8 volts. Now, somebody, I think it was that guy, was asking me earlier about, does anybody have any kind of, or is there any way to make a non-deterministic circuit? And I think that's the way you do it. You starve the chip of voltage until it starts to act kind of crazy. We laugh, but from the limited information I've seen from Intel about the new RD RAND instruction and some of their new x86 CPUs, they've figured out how to implement a random number generator with digital circuits. And they won't say how they figured it out other than it was a vast improvement on the previous analog circuit that was in the Southbridge. The previous analog circuit basically worked by I think it had an ADC with the ground that they left floating so that the voltages would just kind of careen around madly. And depending on what kind of a mood the chip was in that day, you either got a zero or a one. But it had the disadvantage that, that was like 15 years ago. I really don't remember anymore. So, drain damage. Memory is very sensitive to low voltage because there's a lot of transistors and, you know, the risk here, of course, is that all your memory or all the interesting things your computer is doing is stored in memory. So voltage problems can have drastic consequences. So this is probably more of an overclocker problem, but if you strain the power supply or if you overload your PC's power supply, it can start sending inadequate amounts of voltage to the memory. And this can also cause bit flips and segmentation faults and program crashes and other weird stuff. I remember there was some years ago hearing a story about some SGI machine where if you yank the power out of the machine or the power failed, really, the memory was particularly sensitive to low voltage, and when the voltage started dropping, it would basically randomize its contents. However, the disk controllers were built out of more robust signaling, I guess. So the disk controller would keep fetching data out of memory and writing it to the disk because that's what it was doing when the power went out. Well, yay. Let's see. So finally, part four, application issues. Torn disk writes. Now this is kind of a weird problem that you wouldn't think about normally. Now, a disk is normally cut up into discrete chunks of 512 bytes called a sector. On modern hardware, it's actually 4,096 bytes. But most programs and most operating systems figured out that you can get far better speeds out of a disk if you write to it in large chunks of data, like megabytes and megabytes at a time. So it's usually doing multi-block transfers. However, while you tell the disk, OK, write this 4K chunk out, what the disk interprets this as is, OK, write to eight different sectors. And what a torn write is basically what happens if the disk starts writing, say, 4 kilobytes, and it gets some progress made. Say it writes out 2 kilobytes worth of data, and then it dies for whatever reason. Now you have a torn disk write because the last 2K of that 4K block still contain the old contents, but the first 2K contain the new contents. And what is that? Aside from being a torn disk write, that probably also means a mess for you. Unfortunately, the operating system doesn't actually verify writes because Unix tries to do the least amount of work possible. I'm sorry, it tries to do a small number of things the right way. So it leaves it up to your application program to decide either I don't care about what I write to the disk, which most programs don't, or I do care, so I'm going to immediately try to reread that data straight from the disk, bypassing all the caching layers to see if it actually got there. Most programs don't do this. You know, some of them, we'll see what kind of weird and odd strategies you can employ to try to work around that. But fortunately, this torn write thing doesn't really happen that much, because most people who actually care about these things have figured out that they care and have implemented secondary power to keep their systems running. But you know, if we're going to put on our tinfoil hats, you can use what's known as a write journal. And basically what this is it's an intent log that says, I intend to write this here, I intend to write this here, I intend to write this here, but I'm not going to go seek all over the disk and cut this up into multiple IOs. I'm going to make one big long note of this, write this out to a special part of the disk or the file or whatever. And that way, if the power should go out, I can go reread what I was doing at the time and push all those changes forward. That way, I will only be jumping from known good state to known good state to known good state, and we won't end up with this messy thing where you end up with stuff that's halfway between generations. But you still got to verify that the journal actually got written correctly. See, another problem that I touched on earlier was lost writes, where you write a buffer to sector X and it gets written to sector Y instead. This is actually a pretty pernicious problem because it's very difficult to recover from and it's kind of difficult to detect. Now, how do we do this? The Linux kernel does have some strategies for dealing with this. Oops. Checksumming. So a cute trick that ext4 and ButterFS use is to store checksums and offset data with each block. This basically says, well, actually, it goes a bit further than that. With the file system, it stores a unique identifier to the file system along with some kind of thing that uniquely identifies that piece of data within the file system, along with the actual, and also a checksum for all the data that's stored inside that block. So when you, if you write all the data blocks out with this extra info, when you read them back in, you can at least say, okay, this belongs to the file system that it's supposed to, and I'm reading back what I think I'm supposed to be reading, so it's good. Or it enables you to say, okay, well, this is bad, so we're just going to signal an I/O error, tell the user to run FISC, and hope nobody gets too mad. You know, it's not as good as being able to fix it or never have it happen in the first place, but at least you know that things have started to go south on you. Actually, there's actually an even more expensive fix to this. There's specialized hardware these days where you can send the checksum and the disk sector number that you think you're writing along with the data to the disk, and the disk will then verify all that and either commit the write to the disk or it will immediately reject it saying, no, something got broken, please try again. And at least that gives you the computer user, well, the operating system really, some opportunity to try again. All right, so unstable page writes. So, well, a few of you might know that the way that the disk cache on Linux works is that you basically have a mapping of memory pages to disk locations. And there's a system called mmap that allows you to directly map these disk cache pages into your application program so that you can directly write them instead of this buffered interface, which causes memory copies and is not as fast as directly writing memory pages. But it has the unfortunate side effect that you can end up in the situation where what a program is writing to a memory page at the same time that the page is being copied over the PCI bus to a disk controller. This is known as the thing that fixes the situation is known as stable pages, and basically what it means is the computer can either be transferring an intact page to a disk controller for eventual committal to the spinning media or whatever, or it can be modifying it, but you can't be doing both at the same time because DMA controllers don't actually guarantee in what order they read a page. Most of them read it from low address to high address, but the PCI specs don't define what happens. The DMA controllers don't define what happens. It could be reading it backwards for all you know. So it's entirely possible to manufacture your own torn writes this way by scribbling on a page while writing it out to disk. And so you end up with some disk block that's half of previous contents and half current contents, and this is not really good. But the saving grace is that Linux will at least notice if you're scribbling on a page while it's trying to write it out, and it will retry the write as soon as it's finished. This way you get at least some updates of the disk blocks, and the hope is that you won't be so mercurial as to try to write to memory at the same time you're trying to flush it to disk, but you know, if you really want to do that, you can. If you really care, and if you want to fix this at an application level, the solution is to double buffer the writes, where the application program will say, I particularly care about not tearing my writes, so I'm going to pause my program, copy the contents to a distinct buffer, and then schedule a thread or something to actually push that separate buffer out to disk while I meanwhile continue writing madly on this page. Oh yes, so a little bit, this is actually the last slide I think, a little bit more about SSDs. So there's this thing called trim and discard, which is basically a command that says, hey SSD, I don't care about this range of disk anymore. This enables the SSD to not work so hard trying to find full erase pages to satisfy your small I/O, basically because the file system can hint to it, hey, I don't need these anymore, don't stress out about reusing them, preserving them, whatever. If you want to go and blow them away, that's fine. Unfortunately, it's really slow on ATA because trim is actually a non-queued command, which means you can't have any other IOs in flight at the same time, which means you have to stop all the other IOs before you can use it. And it turns out that enough people use Windows XP, which doesn't support trim, that the SSD manufacturers collectively said, you know what, let's just make our algorithms in the SSD smarter to work around this problem. So it turns out that trim and discard really aren't as useful as we thought they would be. So just to throw in a random hodgepodge note, it's not some horrible life or death scenario if you forget to turn it on. Question in the back? They're really the same thing. Trim is the, let's see. Discard is the generic name for a command that's called trim in ATA and unmap. Well, there's a bunch of variants of it in SCSI land. SCSI has like unmap, write same, and a few others. So recommendations. The overkill solution is to cut up your files into discrete chunks, store checksum and file offsets with each block, and push all the writes through the journal and use fsync to flush data out. This is probably overkill because that's a lot of engineering work, and the FS already does most of this already anyway. So the TLDR solution is make sure you use fsync when you actually need to make sure that data is written out to disk. Lobby your local file system developer, that'd be me, to make the FS safer by putting in more checksums and other safety safeguards, and don't buy crappy hardware. Sounds like an OS guy, right? In the future, disks will act like memory. We're probably going to maintain the well-defined storage block interface. However, a new feature that's not too far away is atomic disk writes, where you can say, I have this gigantic range of data that I want to write, and I want you to either write all of it or none of it. And the disk will actually do this. And on the software side, the file systems will hopefully become more robust. Checksums have begun to happen. Online FISC has begun to happen. And maybe someday we'll have like ECC or something to actually reconstruct corrupted file systems and corrupted files. And yeah, I know, I said all this last year at Open Source Bridge and haven't done anything about it. All right, wrap up. Thanks all for attending and letting me talk your heads off for an hour, 45 minutes.
We have a few minutes for Q&A if you want to.
Yeah, questions?
I remember many years ago when I first started using battery backups, one of the selling points was that it also did power conditioning. And I was in Southern California where in the summer you might get a little dip in your AC. Is that still true? And do laptops just solve that because they're constantly running off the battery?
I don't know for the question was, do laptop batteries do power conditioning because they have a large battery attached to them? And I don't actually know that they do that or don't do that. I imagine they probably do to some extent. But I'm not actually intimately aware of at what levels will the power control hardware cut off the AC and decide it's garbage and just go straight to battery, or whether it will actually try to massage it and keep the voltage levels constant. You'd think it would, but you know, we do live in the world of $200 laptops. Any more questions? Well, there was a guy, let me put it this way, ButterFS has a lot of technological improvements that sound incredibly amazing and are really cool. I haven't quite decided yet if I actually like the copy on write behavior, which yes, you can turn it off, but why would you? But really, I think the thing that sums up the current status of ButterFS is someone asked just yesterday on the ButterFS IRC channel, where can I find a production-ready kernel with ButterFS? And someone said, oh, I don't know, 3.22. The kernel that might get released next week is 3.10. Question? Do you mean no? The question was about using no A time on SSDs. Do you mean no A time as compared to rel A time, or? Well, the default these. Originally, the thought was we'll go from full A time to no A time, except this turns out it breaks MUT because MUT figures out whether or not mail messages have been read or not by comparing the access to the modified times. So rel A time was introduced, which basically says, what is it? If the modified time is ahead of the access time, then we'll update it. Or if the access time hasn't been updated in more than a day, we'll update it. But otherwise, don't bother. Which cuts down on some of the A time writes and actually speeds up directory searching a fair amount.
I know you didn't really mention it, but what's your thoughts on
Well, more generally, my opinion of RAID is that it's pretty close to death at this point. The problem, I've looked at vendor spec sheets for SSDs, and they say, well, the error rate is 1 bit in every 10 to the 14 bits, which turns out is, I think, around 10 or 12 terabytes. This is more of a problem in the disk world, where you can buy 4 terabyte disks and scrub them 3 times, and boom, you hit a bit error. This is not as big of a problem with SSDs because most of us can't afford a 2 terabyte SSD. But in general, I think we are heading towards the RAID cliff where it just doesn't work anymore because that server I'm having problems with also has a RAID 1 of 2 terabyte disks. And we have actually hit the problem where we've killed RAID disks by trying to save the RAID by adding more disks to resync it. And so for a while, we will run through this horrible cascade of failing disks as we try to keep up by shoving more disks in. And I'm not sure what we're going to do for the next machine. I've read a paper about erasure codes, and it was a whole lot of unreadable mathematics that I still don't understand. Conceptually, it sounds like the kind of thing that might actually be some kind of solution if anybody can understand it. I don't know. It seemed about as incomprehensible to me as the soft updates paper for BSD file systems. All right, any more questions? Or I see people poking their heads in the door, so maybe we should adjourn.